Stalker is a misunderstood title. For most people, it seems like an unpolished adventure from Ukraine, built to frustrate the player into quitting. For more experienced players, it is a philosophical commentary about human nature and how greed and violence affects the world. To me, it is a beautifully crafted experience and lesson in patience and tranquility. This is my attempt at beating the game with only pistols, the weakest class of weapons in the game. For people that have not yet been acquainted with this cult classic, I will explain a few concepts that will make it a bit easier to understand. Artifacts are pieces of material generated by physical anomalies. They enhance the user with abilities and are very lucrative money-wise. Therefore, we use them to gather funds. Traders give worse rates for goods because our reputation isn't that high with the corresponding faction. Stashes are backpacks or crates where other stalkers left their things for safekeeping. We start off with the loner faction as it's the most independent and allows the player to experience the game from most angles. Should clarify that while I do not intend to delve deep into the lore, if you want to play the game yourself, I'd advise you to click off. Or if you're interested in the lore, I heavily recommend the channel Anomalous Dugout. He is far more competent and focused on these sort of things. Now, we must outline a few rules. The run was done on Vanilla, the current Steam patch, without the complete 2009 overhaul, as I felt it added too much and changed some of the game's aspects. I'm not allowed to use any two-handed guns, only pistols. Grenades are allowed because pistols are a big enough handicap for me already. I'm allowed to use hidden caches and Easter eggs to my advantage. I must complete the game with any ending. All of this out of the way, my masochistic journey begins in the basement of a slimy trader known as Sidorovich, whose associate saved me after I nearly died in an isolated incident trying to leave the zone. With barely anything to my name and a pistolet Makarova to gain my fame, I head off to the harsh wasteland of this Ukrainian exclusion zone for adventures anew and to track down the man named Gunslinger who put us in this predicament. First, I jump on a few roofs to get an upgraded suit, and only then I move on to clear some bandits out of the local parking lot. The bandits were barely pushovers and served no other reason than to get the ball rolling. After rescuing the captured informant, he gives us a task to reacquire a perfected bandit suit, and this is where we face our first death of the run. I'm sure that we won't have many of those. With the suit in my backpack and a quick supply run to Sidorovich's bunker later, we are off towards the military-controlled bridge for reasons rather be seen than explained. After dealing with him, we walk over to the commander's corpse to retrieve our first trusty companion, the forked 15 pistol. This is a noticeable upgrade as it holds 15 entire rounds to tickle my enemies with. Moving on, I entered the garbage, got a lot of ammo for my weapons, used a grenade for the first time, got Strelok's hideout's whereabouts, and was off to the Agroprom complex. Few more deaths later, I met up with Mole, who instructed me to go down to the underground and find the stash of the man who left me for dead. In the underground, climbing down a spiral staircase, I knew what was waiting for me. My first serious challenge in the form of a bloodsucker. Killing him was not easy. Apparently 9x18 bullets are not effective against mutants with thick skin. Shocker. Found the stash, stole a USB drive, started hearing voices of military soldiers, dealt with the military soldiers, climbed out, and entered the Agroprom military complex. This is where I thought I would give up. I had no hopes of breaking through their lines and successfully getting the documents and leaving, but in my moment of despair, a vision came to bear me an inspiration so large I assaulted the main building, killed the commander, pushed onwards to leave as fast as humanly possible. Getting held down by the main door, I had two choices. Slowly and methodically fight it out with the better armed soldiers of the Ukrainian military, or follow Joseph Joestar and tactically run away with my pride shattered. So, without a doubt in my mind, once I had the window of opportunity, I ran. Escaping the Agroprom and dodging bandit gunfire in the garbage, I arrived at Rostock, where I finally get to meet Barman, the traitor who will be essential for my survival and success in the later game. He set me off to a new assignment towards the Dark Valley. Along the way to my destination, I met a very kind bandit who had a storming AN-94 assault rifle. I could have used that, but I could give it to a member of duty who would graciously pay me for my troubles. Upon entry, I assisted duty in freeing one prisoner of war, who informed me that a second one is being held hostage in the bandit base I was going to. So, knowing that this is a mission of most importance and the life of a stalker is on the line, I carefully infiltrated the base through a back pipe, hoping to not be noticed. As I carefully sneak around one of the buildings, a voice is heard shouting that my cover is blown, and it all erupts to chaos. I simply couldn't walk away from this. I was going to have to shoot my way out of their home. And his merry bandits dead, his piece of the key acquired, and lockers looted, I went downstairs to free the duty prisoner after assaulting his captors. Leaving the bandit complex and heading towards the entrance to Lab X-18, my recently acquired Walther P99 had a moment that earns its history as a trusty workhorse that I would be advised to keep for as long as humanly possible. Just kidding, it's a piece of garbage, and I'd be looking for an upgrade in my earliest convenience. Entering the underground lab, I had a few objectives and challenges laid out in front of me. First, acquired the monolith suit. Descend downstairs and kill the pseudo-giant, and finally, kill the pyrogeist to get the documents I came here for. Well, that was rather easy. After my dream about what posting anti-pedophile content on Twitter feels like, I am greeted by the notion that the military has come because I accidentally borrowed one of their secret documents. Not to worry, I channeled my inner Joestar and ran away again. Having returned to Cordon, a message from Sidorovich sent me back to the camp, where I found out that the boys needed help fighting off some mercs, being forever in their debt for saving me. I charged in and dealt with the growing issue before it even touched the camp. I did this because I had an immense respect for the independent fellows who saved me from a terrible fate, and because the money they offered was good. After acquiring some more funds for my essential needs, I returned to Rostock for my next assignment.
One that wouldn't be as easy as the previous. I'd have to fight through waves of mercenaries working for private investors, stalkers who have been affected by psychological emissions and are now not much more than husks or zombies, if you will, and mutants from your worst nightmares. At the end of it all, some closure and more information to aid my long journey would be provided, allowing me to discover the mysteries of the North and to find Strelok, the man behind this madness. My first encounter with the mercenaries who stood in my way ended in an interesting predicament. Gentlemen, what is the first bit of training you receive for battle when assaulting or defending? Yes, little Ivan?
Not bunch up, in case the enemy has grenades!
Correct. So naturally, our enemy as a well-trained and privately funded army had bunched up and allowed me to take out multiple of their snipers with just two grenades, also allowing me to capture a soldier for myself, a prisoner of war if you will, which I promptly executed and moved my rating on the moral compass a bit down. Unimpressed with the opponents, I soldiered on where I must offend Blackwater's pool of operators by at least 50% and descended into a tunnel where we would meet our savior during this playthrough, Big Ben. A fusion of steel and pure unadulterated hatred, firing the subsonic 9x39 developed by the Russians to be a covert armor-piercing round for special operations and high-value targets. Now, I am no scientist, but the Desert Eagle, which is the real-life counterpart of the firearm I just picked up, has a variety of calibers that can be used with it. The largest one is 50 Action Express, a big, overkill round made to stop anything in its tracks. We have it pictured here. I must repeat myself, but I do not comprehend how can you fit a rifle caliber such as 9x39 into this gun. For the dimension comparison, here are they side by side. Yeah, fairy tales. Beyond that, I escorted the ecologist I came here for through the construction site and marched on to the tunnel with the burner anomaly, which would net us some nice artifacts and some good economic gains. In Yantar's ecologic research laboratory, before I could be given the protective helmet, I had to walk the escort Professor Kruglov to take the precise radiation measurements for the calibration of the unit. And of course, while we were taking these measurements, a blowout came out of the blue and it caused me to black out and have another dream. One where two unfamiliar voices were talking about leaving someone behind.
We can't just leave him like that.
Just leave him, there is nothing we can do for him. The blowout.
Spooky. I had to walk the dog back, get the helmet, and move towards the factory complex concealing another secret laboratory. Bombard the locals, avoid their pets, run through, and I'm inside a lab. This is one more of those moments where I run past everything, flip the switches, take a few artifacts, and deactivate the machine causing blowout, which for some reason causes me to black out and have another dream where it is conveniently revealed to us that I, in fact, am Strelok. We tread forward to find what attracted us to the north in the first place. As I crawl out of the tunnels leading outside, I can hear military hinds flying in the distance and firing immense amounts of rockets at the inhabitants of Yantar's industrial sector. Returning to the scientists and stocking up on the most necessary of supplies, mainly 9x39 ammo and medkits, once more I move to the bar, where upon arrival barkeep's goods have been expanded and contain my second tool for success, the exoskeleton suit.
Ah yes, the exoskeleton. Pure science fiction and mandatory if you're bad or if you're not sure how many supplies you'll have in the hours to come. Being 100,000 rubles short, I decided to run around, collect stashes, artifacts, kill, loot, pillage, and plunder, or in simpler terms, acquire more assets. Along the way, I met up with Guide, an experienced stalker who told me to meet Doc in the underground I visited earlier. Upon entry, I found a rare and profitable moonlight artifact and four rather hungry bloodsuckers. Then I was knocked out, barely survived, and had some senile old man talk about some decoder he saw in a dream once. Returning to Rostock, thinking I won't be able to come up with the cash for the suit, I decided to sell off everything I didn't need, like a heroin user at 3 a.m. Actually, that's a pretty good summary for this entire playthrough. But then, in my darkest hour, I saw the arena. A blunt sport fueled by money, encouraged by honor, and performed in a basement. So naturally, I signed up, hoping to get the first stage, as it's one of the two stages where the weapons suit my challenge, the other being grenades.
Regrets. I've had a few. But then again, too few to mention, I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I love.
But despite that, I beat the entire arena using my knife, even with the game throwing what it can at me, including glitches. Shambling towards the entrance of the bar, stuffed in my pocket was the money necessary to progress further, but I had it, one way or another. For the price of a Renault Clio in Germany, I had acquired a suit that allowed me to withstand much more than the common bulletproof vest-wearing stalkers. A suit to give me hope in the coming hours of despair. My mission? To deactivate the brain scorcher that protects the North from the masses of factions south of the border. Seeing as I had not much more to do, I went to the army warehouses and ended up in the base of Freedom, Duty's biggest enemy. Seeing as I had freed Duty's prisoners of war, cleaned the mercs out of the nearby territory, I thought it would only be fair to inform the Freedom leader, Lukasz, about the squad of Duty members right next to their base. I also performed a pilgrimage to meet Freedom's biggest enjoyer of the Forbidden Greens and converse to him about the pressing issues of our modern age. With these two sacrificial events done, I was ready for the onslaught waiting for me at the border region, where the boys turned to men, and the men to Swiss cheese. Talking to the Freedom officer on site, he outlined his vast politics on deserters and the importance of our position. I was impressed by his dedication and study to the Saddam Hussein art of war. Nevertheless, our conversation ended, and the local brainwashed zealots of the monolith arrived, bearing gifts aplenty and a bad omen for the coming hours. See, the pistol I'm using, the one I complained about roughly 900 words ago, was good at killing anyone who stood in my way, unless they had an exosuit. Fortunately for me, many enemies in the game do not wear exoskeleton suits. They wear enhanced suits, and can take multiple bullets to the head. The assault being dealt with, I would journey deeper into the zone, and this is the point, sitting behind this very rock, where I realized that I am on Linux, and the game's stuttering performance could be improved with one command. Needless to say, I felt very disappointed in myself, and had serious self-esteem issues for the coming hours of gameplay. Infiltration of the base was my goal, and to spare my armor, I chose to run through the forests and not the main road to save some of my armor. Finally, after running through the base, I entered the cursed laboratory and had a shocking revelation. Bloodsuckers are still very dangerous to me, even with this futuristic and highly advanced suit of servos and plates. So I decided that I would strafe past them and leave them for the Monolith boys to enjoy. Deactivated the machine, had a dream, fought my way out, mercilessly executed a thick fella, and was out of the lab in comparatively no time. Then, with the Ukrainian military starting quarantine procedures, I dashed past their gunfire and headed to the beautiful city of Pripyat. While leaving the radar base, Sidorovich informed me that a squad of veterans is marching towards the CNPP, and they're gathering in Pripyat. And would you look at that, with these heavily armored professionals, my journey would surely be nearing its end soon. And they're dead. In that case, there's nothing more to do than to raid Fang's stash, get an upgraded exosuit, get a decoder mentioned by Doug from the hotel, and then I figured out that the Monolithians have become so tired of my tried and tested running away tactics that they started using rocket launchers to fire warning shots. Still, I took a longer route and prevailed. Approaching the stadium past the Culture Palace, I was greeted by a cutscene showing me the field of anomalies and monolith rocketeers I'd have to go through. And then it teleported me to the level exit. Entering the CNPP and getting closer to the gate entrance, I noticed a BTR approaching. Knowing its cannon can rip me to shreds, I sought solitude behind the wall and was bombarded by RPGs. Luckily, for some reason I managed to sneak through along the side of the building and entered the sarcophagus. The tunnels themselves felt like something straight out of Dante's Inferno. Unending thick boys, Grozas and ARs on every corner, with a few spaz shotguns mixed in. This nearly drove me to develop an unhealthy addiction to the Serum of the Gods, Doras Traditionis. But I managed to abuse the AI, clean them out, and find the door to the deeper sections of our beloved fourth reactor. By this point, I had entered the ninth circle of the Inferno, loading my mags and killing my quick save keys with never before seen vigor. Defeating the last defenders led me to a strange room, and without a second doubt, I smashed the blue arcs that transported me to a room with a hologram-like entity who started explaining the answers to all the questions I had.
We are the result of an experiment aimed at creating a super consciousness called C-consciousness.
Lame. I'm left with two choices, to join the people who brought us such horrors as Monolith Thick Boys, Emissions, and some of the monsters in the zone, or take them on and possibly die in the process. So I chose to side with them to avoid further suffering. No. No, I didn't. I continued the raid alone to finish what I started, jumping from teleporter to teleporter, killing those who stood in my way, knowing the rest who were left behind would be caught by the aftershock. As I tread closer, the final stretch is in front of me, a monolithian armed with an RPG to my 9 o'clock and the ladder to the last teleporter on my 12. I lead my charge, knowing that I do not have the necessary resources to close the distance or to prolong the fight and possibly defeat the monolithian with the rocket launcher. So, in my final attempt, I jumped through, grabbed onto the ladder, climbed on, and as I stepped forward, two squads of heavily armed monolithians appeared out of nowhere. Reloading a quick save, I decided that all I had to do was throw a couple of grenades. And as only one more monolithian was standing in my way, I shot him down like the dog he was. With his body dropping to the floor, I jumped into the last teleporter, ending my suffering and ending the challenge forever. Well, that was difficult. Apart from being outraged and outgunned, I completed the game by save scumming and vigorously abusing my enemies' lack of intelligence. I think Stradlock summarizes my thoughts quite well in this final cutscene.
I don't know whether I was right or wrong. I guess I'll never know. But I made it. And I guess I should be thankful for that.
Thank you for watching. I'd like to extend a big thanks to my wife for suffering through my endless complaints or monologues on how to improve this video, and my parents for staying silent when the words disappointment should have been said. I'll probably get around to completing the other Stalker games with this challenge as well, and maybe, just maybe, if I feel like suffering enough, I'll complete Stalker Anomaly with pistols only.